I'm Ken Schwaber. I've been involved with Scrum for some 20 years, so if you do want to blame someone, you found the right person. So what we're going to talk a bit about today is kind of a weird topic with Scrum. It's about done. Weird word. Would have never thought that I would care about it, except I was in a project at TransCanada Pipelines back in 2004 when I started should have started realizing it was significant. We were building a system of feeds of property titles into a database. All the property searches had been done manually to that date, and we had automated after the third sprint one of the feeds from Manitoba into the database. And our customer looked at us and said, "That is so wonderful." She said, "I know you only have one feed up right now, but if you could give us that and automate that and put us in our office and teach a SQL, we could, you know, save ourselves a lot of work." And we all were looking and we're like, well, we're actually not done. She said, "But you know, you showed it to me. It's done. It's ready." I said, "Oh, well, it's not that type of done." I said, "Oh, what type of done is it?" I said, "Well, it's more like our type of done." She said, "How long would it take you for you to move it from your type of done to my type of done where I can really use it?" I said, "Oh, geez, you know, like maybe another 2 months or so." And she said, "How do we reconcile this from now on so I actually know what you're talking about?" And since Scrum is based on transparency, that was a very transparent moment. That we actually, she had no idea what we were talking about, and we thought we were being clear as cloudy milk. What I wanted to show you was this very, very simple artifact called the increment. And potentially, the increment at the end of any sprint is supposed to be done. And you might say done might mean, I looked this up in the dictionary, check it. It says there's no work left to be done. I was like, wow, that's pretty clever. And if you understand that and you all use the same definition, then it's pretty obvious what we mean by it. And the reason why I'm discussing it this morning is the failure to have an absolutely transparent definition of done is the undoing of everything that you try to do in Scrum. Literally, if I walk into an organization, they'll say, you know, without even, you know, shaking hands on that, "Can you show me your definition of done?" And if there's a pause, if there's a stutter, if there's a, well, it depends, then they are in deep trouble. So these are some definitions I came up with, you know, if I were a programmer and I wanted to work on some software, what things would make me glad to do so? And the first one would be, I can readily understand it, and how it works, and how things happen. And when I change part of it, there's no unintended consequences. Wow, you know, so just what I'm changing actually changes. That I can read the code without looking for tricks or poorly defined and badly labeled variables. I don't need the people who wrote it to explain it to me. There's a full set of automated tests to check that the function works as expected. And when I change something and add to the test, I can see that the entire change and all the product as it was before, continue to work. That how things work and hang together is transparent. And that there's standard, well-known design principles that have been adhered to. Does that sound like a reasonable thing to wish? I mean, when you buy a book, you want to be able to read it. So you would probably throw away a book that doesn't conform to these sorts of things. So I would expect this as just some minimal set. Actually, I'm being facetious. I would be so happy if I ever ran into this. You know, just you don't find it that often. This is the iron triangle of Agile. And it's just, you know, three variables, and you get your choice of two of them. And that's it. One is what work needs to be done, which we represent with a product backlog, timeline. And the third is our velocity. That is our ability to turn things that the customers want into something that's done and usable, that is no undone work remains, across time. So you could measure that as the number of product backlog items per $100,000. That would be one way of stating it. And this tends to be pretty fixed. It changes across time as a team gets better, as a team learns to self-organize. It changes as the engineering tools and practices improve. But it's not something where you can look someone in the eyes and say, give me more velocity, and they can just push down the accelerator. It's what it is at any point in time. And this tends to be pretty good if you're using a greenfield project. Maybe in our experience, 18, 19, 20, you know, it's pretty good. So here is a, I know you all got up waiting to be entertained, but instead here's work for you, right? You are developers at a company called XYZ, and you're building advanced life-critical products. Nothing to sneeze at. Your Scrum team is one of seven Scrum teams working on a new release of the product. Your team is going to select some requirements and turn them into something that's done, no more work remains, within a two-week iteration or sprint. Every one of your teams has all the skills needed to fully develop the requirements into something that's done. So the question for you is, what work would you have to do to turn those requirements into something that's done? That is, would you have to do some analysis? Would you have to do some coding? Would you have to do some refactoring, unit testing? What type of work is inherent as a software development professional in turning a requirement from a customer into something that is done? So when you sat down, you may have sat down with strangers there now, just like we do with teams of Scrum, a team. So I'd like you guys to work on this for about 5 minutes and come up with what you think you would have to do so. Let's see if, here's some of the items. So you did have performance testing, right? Stability testing, refactoring, immunological response testing. Didn't hear that. I mean, you do want to make sure early on that it doesn't kill the patient, correct? Otherwise, by the time you're done ready for release, it'll really kill the patient, right? Integration with the work of the other six teams. Wow. Matter of fact, integration testing with the work of the other six teams, so the increment is the totality of all seven. Release notes, oh, internationalization to the six cultures where the product will be sold. User acceptance testing, regression testing. Most of you had this, just a few items were missing. So this should be definition done. And as Scrum is working, you would only select as much work as you could do all these things too. Right. So as Scrum goes, or any iterative incremental practice actually, you have a small planning phase at the start, and then you have a just-in-time planning step, development, this is one sprint, just-in-time planning, development, one sprint, just-in-time planning with development, just-in-time planning, development. And at the end, we have this very, very small period where we do the work that is specific to the release, but not necessarily to each increment. And that should be very minor. However, almost every organization that I visited has a slight variant of this, where they do the replanning, they have their sprint, and then they have something that's done, but also they leave behind a trail of undone work. And that might be, you know, defects, that might be we couldn't internationalize within the sprint, didn't have time to check and see if it killed someone, oh, we couldn't integrate our work with the other six teams. You know, we just didn't have time, so they leave behind undone work. And this then creates a pile of undone work that accumulates. And that leads us to our classic, traditional, honored phase at the end of the project called stabilization, which is otherwise known as do everything you can to make it work. And the amount of time for that would normally be the amount of time that the undone work has accumulated, except undone work doesn't accumulate linearly. It accumulates in some sort of exponential fashion that is totally unpredictable. So you get to the end of the release, and work that you could have fixed at the end of the first sprint now has other stuff piled on top of it, an assumption upon assumption, and when you go to actually fix it, Lord knows where you're going to be.